Okay, I guess we can start. Hi, my name is Tomasz Gawłowski. I work in Abvento. We are focus-oriented, Drupal-oriented agency software house. Today I'll be talking about performance in the context of Drupal, in general and in the context of Drupal. Okay, what I want to be talking about today. How to build or optimize an infrastructure. Last year, Damian, okay, so, agenda. What is the performance, the web performance? I guess we can find a dozen of definitions, and I don't think that there will be a one universal definition for that. Why the performance is important? Of course it is, but why? How to clarify to someone why it's important to spend some resources, some time, some money on that. What to measure, how to measure, bottlenecks, and also, of course, Drupal and the performance. Okay, let's go. So, free slide from Wiki. There's a definition of web performance. That's the time when the page is loaded. So, but it's too simple. It shouldn't be a single number because there is a lot of people from a lot of regions with different devices, and the time on different devices is not the same. And also, when we should start to count and stop to count. On the right side is amazon.com. That's the look after 2 seconds. Whole page was loaded in 13 seconds on my laptop. So, for me it's just fine. Of course, it's enough to browse, enough to find something, etc. Okay. Why the performance is important? On this part, I based on this book by Tammy Everts. Time is money. Nice book with a lot of cool examples, and also about on the performance and monitoring from Dizon. So, how to convenience the project sponsor or yourself, your client, project manager, some marketing professional to spend resources on the performance, to spend, I don't know, 2 weeks for 1 second improvement. We have to speak their language, we have to understand them. We have to convince them that performance has implication to the business, to the revenue. Examples. SEO, PageSpeed Insights. Google provide us this tool, PageSpeed Insights. I guess all you know this. It is in the internet, so it's the truth. You can see that your page is average, medium, or poor, or great, etc. So, for people who are not technical, it's a good source of knowledge. So, performance has significant influence on SEO. Impact on brand. Research by Radwell, they test brand perception on one big group divided in half, and the one part of this group has the same page, but it was displayed, this page was displayed with a lack of 500 milliseconds. It's loaded in less than less than half of the second slower. And, of course, people noticed that this page is slower, but also when they ask about the brand, they start to using negative phrases like boring, inelegant, clunky, tacky, and hard to navigate. It is not connected directly with the speed. Okay. So, slowness versus downtime. Lenny Rakczynski, product manager from Airbnb, claimed that it's better to be down than to be slow. Akamai, the major CDN provider, they publish a lot of statistics. They also publish this sentence. So, according to this, 3 times more person will abandon page for permanent when you are slow than when you are offline. So maybe we should set some limits when we just stop to provide our services, our app, and okay. Influence on the bounce rate. Another situation, another test from the ITSI. Slowness implicates bounce rate. Bounce rate implicates budget on marketing. Implicates effectiveness of this budget. So it's easy to see the connection. And influence to the conversion. It is significant and measurable. It's easy to show real money behind optimization. For one e-commerce vendor, when the load time was 6 seconds, the conversion rate shrank about a half. Case studies from Intuit. It's a accounting service provider. Also 30% when they speed up their page, and Mozilla and Stamplus. Everybody claimed that it has significant influence. Okay. And now it is on the internet, so it must be the truth. Google provide us another tool, impact calculator. You can fill it with your current speed, average monthly visitors, conversion rate, and average order value. Plus, you can change here. Okay. I guess. You can change the time. You can set your goal here for 3 seconds from 5.5 and see the revenue of this change. It is on the internet, so it must be true. Okay, let's play. A real company disclosed its revenue from one service. It's $4 billion a year, US dollars. And that's the statistic for them, that the page is inside, and the calculation with the speed of 3 seconds is at 5.5. So, $250 million. A lot. And the company is cloudgoogle.com. That's the test for them. So, maybe they should move to AWS stack or something. Anyway, common sense is a must in this situation. So, of course, impact calculator is just the tool. And we have to keep in mind return of investment and check it fast if it's possible, of course. and it is, generally. Google Analytics provides us a nice matrix, and with Google Analytics we can calculate return of, investment. If we be able to compare slower, we are able to compare slower users with faster users. And if our site application provides some statistics of conversions, we can see the difference between these two users, these two groups. One more thing about performance. It's the part of the site is not a okay. We shouldn't start optimization from the slowest page. We should start optimization from the most important pages. So, the product detail page, category browser for the e-commerce, of course, and home, that's the top. Product detail page is 12 times more important than shopping bag, and 50% more important than home. That's the implication to the conversion. Awesome. Okay. How to start? We have to measure what we do. We have to have metrics for what we measure. It's good practice to make an opening if we start to optimize something. It's a good practice to make an opening report and log your progress. The metrics. Typical metrics which we use often, they are good for lab, backend, etc. Time to first bytes. The time when the server starts to sending the data. Request time, whole request from the server. We can use it for this curl, Firebug, DevTools, and a bunch of other stuff. Capacity and scaling, request per second and concurrent users. AB, HTTP, and CH, it's a good stuff for that. Also, there is a lot of SAS services for that. Other are out of the scope of the presentation. That's the good, these metrics are good for the lab, for backend. But real life is quite different. A few months ago, if I remember correctly, Google developed user-centric performance metrics. And they called them like that. First paint, so you see something on a screen. It's working. First, contentful paint. There is something. First, mainful paint. So we see the content. And time to interactive. So we can do something. And this metrics, we can find this metrics in Google Analytics and also in DevTools. So we can measure it. So the key question here is, what's the performance? How to measure the performance? To the first paint, to the first mainful paint, time to interactive or through page load? I don't know. Okay, good practice. A good practice for development is to add testing to your development process. Most of us build the applications with functionalities in first place. Then we are worried about performance, and usually we have no budget for that. So if you have, I don't know, Jenkins or something similar, you can use Curl, you can use webpage test.org, which is quite good, and it provides API, and blackfire.io also, which provides API. Call them during your continuous development process and see how see the history. So if you find out that something went wrong and your application starts to be slower, you can find in the history when it starts to be slower. Good practice. Be proactive. So use application performance monitoring like New Relic, or Pingdom is not a IPM, APMI. It's just a monitoring tool, but New Relic is a huge and great tool. If you don't know New Relic yet, go for it. It's very, 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 very useful tool for us. Okay. Bottlenecks. There's a lot of bottlenecks in the system, in the application. What you should remember all the time is the difference between memory access, network access, SSD access, HDD access, and a time to travel by package around the world. The difference is huge. So when you think about performance, we should start from these big numbers, from the distance. Maybe your site is far away, your clients are far away from you, and for each interaction you lose 100 milliseconds. If you have HDD disk, you should look at the solutions which are focused on caching in RAM. The return of your time investment will be bigger than when you use SSD. Okay, fast forward with general overview. If you have networking, how to optimize what tools we should use. If you have users around the world, you should use CDN. You should optimize your DNS. So A versus CNAME is slow. It's extra one more call to CD to DNS. Anycast, it's similar to CDN, but for DNS. And the good solution, the good idea is to set XDNS prefetch control to on. If you set this to on, browser will send request to the DNS servers instantly. And it will be faster. We should use keep alive if it's possible. HTTP/2 is a great advantage. It's a great tool which improve us, improve our services. Of course, compression is a must. And of course, cache static files. Tools to debug. To check what is going on. Of course, dig and drill for DNS. Trace route to see where is your server, how to connect, what's the route to the server. Looking graph, if you want to check where is your server, if you are, I don't know, in USA. TCP dump, if you are looking through the traffic. Firebug DevTools, quite obvious. Okay, let's server. Memory. It's a must. Swap is a swamp. If you server running out of memory, your performance dropping to the floor, it doesn't work. You have to check the Earth limits. Default limits are for average situations, not for web UI, not for web applications, etc. So how much open files, how much the process can, how much files process can you can have open, etc. Save and check your I/O per second. You can disable HT access. Opcache validate timestamp should be set to zero if you can do it. Especially with Drupal or Symfony, it's very useful and it has it improves the performance. Tune, disable locks. Every call, every write to log is a write to disk. Of course, use cache everywhere where you can. Limit tuning, execution time, memory limits, etc. It should be in your, if you have a simple infrastructure with one server, it's quite easy to set it, to set this up. But if your infrastructure is more complicated, if you have some reverse proxy or something, it's this values should be connected. If you have keep alive timeout, it should be the same on reverse proxy and on the web application server. Go for PHP 7. It's also a big improvement. And opcache everywhere. Oh, we know that Drupal loves database very much. And the tune of database, it's important. You have to check for slow queries. You have to check the performance. PHP MyAdmin, MySQL, MySQL Workbench provides a good analytics for that. Percona tools are also useful. PHP FPM also provides slow logs. It's worth to set it up. More tools: Uptime, Tap, S-Trace, SSE, and IO Stats. It's all for your server. Debugging. Okay. External calls. If it's possible, not from the backend. If you call to the external service from your backend, you have to add time to your call. If it's possible, call via front. Cache calls. If it's possible. If you call to external services, push your push the answer to the to your local local cache, to database or Redis, whatever, and set proper timeouts. Okay, Drupal basic. Sorry, it's the most is obvious. Of course, we have to disable devel on the production. It's obvious, but life shows that it's not obvious for everyone. We have to handle errors. PHP, check your status reports, every warning, every error, takes time. Cache everything what you can, you have to cache. We have to aggregate our CSS, JavaScript, and call to Chrome via Chrome tab or some external services, never with a user session. Also, of course, basic HTML and CSS optimization. We should protect editors and users against themselves. So if user can upload an image, we should set a limit, of course. Because the they have a few, okay. And of course, if some module is unnecessary, we have to disable it. Okay. letter write to disk is of course better. So logging statistics, we can tune it. If you don't need your logs, save it. If you don't need statistics, if Google Analytics is enough for you, disable. Let's field. Every field is brings more calls to database. So less fields, better performance. So search is a huge improvement in the case of search. Not only but the speed improvement is significant. We can put cache logs to Redis or Memcache. Usually it helps a lot. If you use Redis, you have to remember to use PHP Redis module for PHP instance, not Redis, because the difference is important. Redirect in Drupal is a bad idea. Another call, move this redirect to HTTP server or some reverse proxy. Last but not least, turn on BigPipe on Drupal 8. BigPipe prioritize what should be sent first, what should be rendered first. So it's similar. Your page will look similar to Amazon or to Facebook, because BigPipe is a technology from the Facebook. So content on top will be provided first, on bottom last, and interactive not cached blocks will be rendered at the end. And use smart tools. We have Drupal Web Profiler. It's a good tool. A huge amount of information. Also New Relic. It's the must, in my opinion, in a situation with if you deal with a bigger applications. And Blackfire, those IO if you need a profiler. One of my favorite things in Blackfire IO is the ability to compare a test between different instances or different probes, so the different state in time. Okay, optimize your front end. So of course use DevTools. Leverage breakpoints to download appropriate image size. A lot of users still on cell phones still use a poor network connection. So smaller image, faster page. Of course, remove unused CSS. Use efficient CSS selectors. So ID classes first, pseudo classes at the end if you must. And if you use third-party scripts, do it asynchronously. Okay. How to build a really fast Drupal app. I think the key, we have two more important things to keep in mind. We have to look at the product, project in holistic way. So it's not. We have to start to think about performance from UX, and we have to we have to the performance first application starts to be on a designer desk. How your UX looks like indicates how fast your application page will be. We have to focus on user, on what will be displayed on the front. We have to focus on the most important pages. Also, in my opinion, front end is a key. How fast it will be rendered. The page, if your web page rendered in 3 seconds, probably only 10% is a call to server, to the backend. Rest is the frontend. And what I said, continuous testing and benchmarking and application performance management also is very important if you rely on application performance. Okay, the end of my monologue. Any questions?
I don't know if it's only my problem, but I have tested Drupal 8 with multiple machines, multiple operating systems, and using, of course, PHP 7 Plus. I encountered that without special settings, I'm using 16 gigs of RAM, SSD. Drupal 8 is a very slow solution on developer's machine. Of course, it runs a lot of faster on external server, but I don't know, is any way to speed up developer's work? You know, Drupal cache cleaning, refreshing pages, you know, the overhead of starting project is very big because of slow performance of Drupal 8 on developer's machine.
I don't know what your configuration is.
I imagine that besides building perfect applications from the scratch, from time to time it happens that you inherit something crappy. So when and how do you start to make it good, let's say, Google Maps in a Google system? I mean, just the idea, so how do you start to analyze the thing?
How?
But what are you firstly taking into account? Front-end, back-end server, whatever?
What's we start from obvious things, so the list was quite good. If you start from the top thing, if we talk about Drupal, I think that this list is quite good to start. First obvious things, maybe server configuration. If you have no option to compare different environments, and if you done this list, or you can go deeper, start to improve, because it's the effort, time consumption and the effect here is huge. Here, so it depends on the particular situation. If Devo is on. For sure your study is slow. Thank you very much for your time.